her and I would walk out in the woods, and she would pull herbs and berries and tree bark, and she'd pull all that out, and then she'd take it home, and she'd make something with it. And then she'd take it over to those people's house, and it would make them well.
Stay good day. Welcome, my friends, to The Storyteller, where you'll find First Nations people from across Native North America who are following Jesus Christ without reservation. Today we'll hear from a Sac and Fox elder as he shares about some of the special people and events in his life, including the most important decision that he would ever make.
My name is Ralph Hamblin. I'm a Sac and Fox Indian here in Oklahoma. I was raised in Shawnee, Oklahoma, with my mother and my father. And my mother was a full-blood Sac and Fox, and my dad was half Sac and Fox and half English. I had four brothers. Three of them were half-brothers, and then my little brother, him and I were same father. We came from a dysfunctional family because, number one, my dad, he was an alcoholic, but he did it in a very quiet way. I don't think I ever saw my dad drink, but I could smell it. And, of course, I knew that him and my mother had their conflicts. But my mother came from a Christian home. She had 17 brothers and sisters. They lived on the Sac and Fox Reservation, which is north of Shawnee, up in a little town called Stroud. And we had that's where our reservation was. My grandfather and my grandma, they were moved from Iowa by the government in about the late 1800s. And they came to Oklahoma, and they settled, got some land. And he was a farmer and a rancher. But the Presbyterian Church came in about 1900, came into the Sac and Fox Reservation, and they started a little church, and it was called the Only Way Baptist Church. And my grandfather was a charter member of that church, and he worked as a deacon. My grandmother worked as a midwife, so she helped deliver a lot of Indian babies. And of course, she had a lot of babies herself. And my mother was the oldest of her brothers and sisters, so they always called her Babe because she was their mama, really, because she took care of a lot of them. And so she knew Christ at an early age, and I'm thankful for that, because in our home she was the spiritual leader of our home. My dad, he never did accept Christ. He heard it, and he heard it, and he just kept rejecting. And then in his later age, he was seeking, but the Lord just quit calling him. And it was sad, but he just kept rejecting it. And so in my life, I was raised there in Shawnee. I was a city boy. But I went to my grandma's house a lot in the summertime, and I'd spend a lot of time with her. She was a lady that talked Sac and Fox all the time, so she didn't talk English. I think she knew, but she just wouldn't do it. And so her and I would have quite a time communicating, but we were able to make each other understand. And I just had a marvelous time spending time with my grandmother. My other grandmother on my dad's side, she was a very hard, she was a little bitty lady. We called her Little Grandma because she was so small. But boy, she was feisty. She was a real go-getter. But she was hard. She was a really hard lady. My other grandma was just a real soft, we called her Cashew Grandma because in the Sachem Fox, the word Kashu means cat. And she had lots of cats around her place. And so we called her Kashu Grandma. And she was just a real loving person. And I liked being around her. Grandma took me to church. And her and I walked to church several times. It was about 4 miles. And we'd walk to church. And that was fun. She lived way out in the country. She lived about 7 miles north of Stroud. She lived on the land that was their allotment. They had each family got 240 acres, and she had that land, and she had a big house on it. And I just had fun being around her. She was always doing something, and she'd get up very early in the morning, and she'd get her old wood stove going. She'd be out there chopping wood, and I'd go chop wood with her. Somebody would call and say somebody was sick in the neighborhood, and she would say, "Come on." And so away we'd go. Her and I would walk out in the woods, and she would pull herbs and berries and tree bark, and she'd pull all that up, and then she'd take it home, and she'd make something with it. And then she'd take it over to those people's house, and it would make them well. I mean, she knew how to use that natural medicine, and she was always doing that. And she had a garden, and she'd have me out there hoeing weeds and things, and I just enjoyed doing that. I remember, and she was just a neat lady that I had a very closeness with. And I remember when she died, I was the last person she talked to, because within the family, and I was outside, and they come out there, and they said, "Ralph," they said, "Grandma wants to talk to you." And I remember going in there and sitting down beside her bed and holding her hand, and she died. That hurt me probably as much as anything when I lost her. She was a really neat person. Lost my little brother about the same way. He got killed in a car accident. He was, him and I was as close as any two boys could have been. We did some crazy things together. But as I grew up there in Shawnee, we had problems. My little brother, my dad really liked my little brother. And so we were kind of separated. My little brother went with my dad, and I was with my mother. And it really created some conflict there. But him and I were just close as could be. And we had lots of good times playing together. And we just went all over the city doing all kinds of things. And we lived on the poor end of town. But to us, it didn't seem like that, because we played baseball and we went down to the creek all the time. And I went through the Shawnee school system. I went from first grade all the way through high school, and then I attended Oklahoma Baptist University, which is located in Shawnee, and I went to school there for a couple of years. And so I knew Shawnee real well. Didn't think I'd ever leave. And started a Indian church there in Shawnee in 1947. So I was about 6 or 7 years old. They started the Indian mission, and my mother was one of the first ones that went there. And then they moved it around different places. So I went to that little church. But then a lot of times down the street, my mother would be working. She worked as a nurse at the Indian hospital there. There was a sanitarium there for tuberculosis patients. And she worked there for 30-some-odd years. And so when she was working and I couldn't go to get to the church, well, there was a little church down the street, and it was called the Oklahoma Avenue Baptist Church. And I went there as a boy so that my Sunday school teacher at that church, his name was Jesse James, and he would take us out on hunting trips, and he would just take us hiking a lot of times. But while we were walking, he would explain about Jesus and about the lostness of people, that you need a Savior. And so I was introduced to Jesus at an early age. And as I listened to him and started understanding what he was saying, well, then the little Indian church, First Indian of Shawnee, they had pastors that were men that was going to school at Oklahoma Baptist University. And they'd come to our place, and they would be our pastor for like 4 years, and then they'd graduate, and then there would be another one come. Well, while I was probably in the fourth or fifth grade, because I was 9 years old. Well, my pastor, his name was Gabe Paxton Jr. He was got out of the Marine Corps and was in the Second World War. I remember he drove a tank. He was a tank driver. I thought that was always really neat to he'd tell us all about driving a tank. But he took us to camps. And one year he took me in 1949, he took me to Falls Creek, and that's a huge camp area in Oklahoma where all the people come down and youth camp, and they just gather, and it's one of the largest youth gathering in the United States. But we had Roland Baxter Camp. That was a program for boys in the church. And so I went to Roland Baxter Camp and down there at Falls Creek. And 1949, I remember sitting on a bed, and my pastor, Gabe Paxton, was sitting there talking to me, and he began to tell me about Jesus Christ. And I realized at that point that I was lost, that I needed a Savior. I needed somebody that could intercede for me. And as I listened to him, and he took the Bible, and he showed me the scriptures, John 3:16, for God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. And he told me, he said, Ralph, he said, that's you. He said, that whosoever was you, and that Jesus died on that cross for you. And I accepted Jesus at that time, right there on that bed.
What an amazing truth, that Jesus died for you. It was the only way that your relationship with God could be restored. Someone has to pay for your wrongdoing. You'll either accept Jesus' payment on your behalf or face God's judgment on your own. But why would you do this? Today you've heard about special relationships and the grief of losing loved ones. Think about how special you must be to God that He would endure such grief in order to make you His own. My friend, that's love. The Bible puts it this way: by this God's love was revealed in us, that God has sent His one and only Son into the world that we might live through Him. And this is love, not that we loved God, but that He loved us and sent His Son as the atoning sacrifice for our sin. If you have any questions or comments, you can write to us at The Storyteller, P.O. Box 1001, Bemidji, Minnesota, 56619. That's The Storyteller, P.O. Box 1001, Bemidji, Minnesota, 56619. Our phone number is 877-766-4648. That's 877-766-4648. You can also find us online at withoutreservation.com. Thanks for listening. And remember, the greatest story took place at the cross. For the wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord. My friends, there's more to Ralph's story, so be sure to join us again next time as we listen to The Storyteller.